you study history?
I studied at Royal Holloway at London University, and I did a degree in medieval and modern history, so I did a fair bit of modern history within that degree, and there was the opportunity to study in London as well, because the degree at that time had sort of London-based elements, so I did a certain amount of medieval London history, and studied in my third year. I did a special study at LSE with John Gillingham, who's a Norman historian, or largely sort of Norman historian. I did a Norman Conquest module there with him, which was very useful. And for an MA, I studied at York University in their Centre for Medieval Studies. So I have an MA in Medieval Studies, which was quite interdisciplinary, so there was bits of literature, bits of archaeology, as well as the history bits. But I ended up basically doing a history dissertation for the Medieval Studies MA, which was sort of put me in good standing for coming here to study for my PhD when this was King Alfred's College back in 1997.
Wow.
So I'm still here.
Why did you decide to study history?
Gosh, various reasons. I think that's personal interest primarily. Also because I was interested in sort of possible careers in journalism or even politics. maybe that's a bit that I can keep quiet about, because I never really sort of, once I went into university, I sort of got into the academic side of things quite a bit, although some of my lecturers might beg to differ. some elements of what I studied, but yeah, I mean, the sort of motivations that no doubt inspire many students here to study history, that sort of interest in things that have happened in particular places in the past. And I got into medieval history quite quickly once I started studying it at university level, so it was, you know, the aspect that things had happened a long, long time ago in these places, and I always found that quite remarkable. It's almost like sort of inhabiting a Tolkien-esque kind of world in a way, that opportunity to look at a society which is completely different from ours, yet in some ways has many elements in common as well. So those are the sorts of things that inspired the sort of childhood love of things from the past, the sort of old-fashioned antiquarian in many ways.
What is your
most
favourite area of history to look at, and why?
Well, the areas that I teach and research on, basically. I kind of hover around the 10th and 11th centuries, because I think some very interesting things are happening in Western European societies around that time. I mean, especially in Anglo-Saxon England, which is my sort of primary area of research. At the moment, I find the Norman Conquest a real fascinating topic. I guess I have done for quite some time as well. And the sorts of reasons, I suppose the kind of reason for the Norman Conquest is that question of was there a major cataclysm for the English state in 1066, or are there degrees of continuity? You know, how far did sort of Anglo-Saxon England continue past 1066? And I guess there's a certain amount of bloody-mindedness really in trying to address how old-fashioned England was in 1066. That sort of question of, was England a sort of moribund state on the eve of the Norman Conquest? I largely think it wasn't, but there are still some historians who think it was. So I think that makes it very interesting there. I think it's really because it's sort of right at the end of what we might call the early Middle Ages, but there's so much, so many sources. Suddenly the sources become, the source material sort of blooms really around the early 11th century. So we can start to start to make inquiries, which are quite sophisticated in terms of things like motivations, people's motivations, the things that drive particular decisions, and the kind of questions that modern colleagues are quite used to asking are just about beginning to be possible in that period. But then again, I still have a fascination for the early Anglo-Saxon period, that sort of period where the age of Sutton Hoo, the age of the conversions to Christianity, because everything is just so it just seems so charged in the atmosphere in that period just seems so charged, and I kind of get a little shiver every time I read the chapter in James Campbell's The Anglo-Saxon, which is about the basically the first Christian kings and the kind of the integration of the archaeology and the history, and that you can basically reach out and touch that period, or it feels like you can reach out and touch that period through the survival of the artifacts from that time, which is I find that quite a fascinating period, although I sort of research less and less on that period as I move more and more into the sort of central Middle Ages in terms of my research.
Why did you become a teacher of literature?
Well, it's the sort of desire to inspire others. I think that's part of it, really. A lecturer's job is quite a good job.
You get nice holidays.
Well, it's not the holiday. I mean, it's the holidays, but you go off somewhere, you go and visit somewhere, and you end up looking around historical monuments and taking photographs. But the sort of study for history never, the interest in history never really leaves you. You end up taking, not necessarily the heavyweight academic books on holiday, but the sort of more readable, that's not the heavyweight academic books aren't readable, but the more readable potboiler type of book. I won't give any examples, but that's the sort of thing you can do on holiday as well. But the lecturing, the job of lecturing is a good one, because part of my contract is to do research as well, to publish and to write, and to write for non-academic audiences as well. That's expected of me. I take that element of it quite seriously. So it's not just the teaching, but there's also the other elements as well. And if you get the balance right, it can be very interesting, very fulfilling. I find the teaching, the lecturing, very fulfilling. Some essays I don't find particularly exciting to read. But on the other hand, you think I'm still sort of engaging with the past, even with the worst essays, I'm still engaging with stuff that. If I'm able to step back from it, I'm able to think, I can do something much worse for a living, much less enjoyable for a living. So.
I'm sure
I do need to remember that. There are some quite, what would we say, less than inspiring elements within the job which are associated with the sort of administration and bureaucracy side of universities. And I think that's a sort of necessary part of the job, but not my favourite part of it.
In what consists that part? Because we know more or less what you do when you're a lecturer and you go there and you give your class and that's it. But we don't really know what you do when you get to your office, apart from, I guess, correct essays.
Right, the sort of research side of things.
Administration, all the things that.
Responding to emails, thinking about documents to do with the validation of particular elements of quality control elements of the job that sort of necessary within a university faculty. In terms of the academic research, it's partly a matter of reading. It's a matter of collecting information, reading primary source material. So at the moment, I'm just starting work on a new project on places of rebellion in Western Europe from around the 9th century through to the 12th century. century, through to round near to the end of the 12th century. And so it's an opportunity for me to start broadening what I actually research on, which has been in the past largely Anglo-Saxon England in the immediate aftermath of the Norman conquest, and looking a bit more in detail at some of the continental sources to compare the ways in which members of the nobility, members of royal families, sort of make these grand statements of rebellion at various points in the early Middle Ages. It's kind of part of the political language of the time. So there's a degree of just sort of looking through the primary sources, seeing what places are mentioned, and part of the sort of legwork is to get all these places on the map, in fact. It's really interesting, and you know, just familiarising myself with the sources, and some interesting places are coming up, really. So, you know, there are opportunities during term time. You know, it might be a couple of hours here and there during the week, but during the vacation periods, that's the sort of opportunity to really get to sort of get down to it. I've been re-editing an article which I wrote a while back on Anglo-Saxon landholding recently, so that's been my sort of main thing, sort of responding to comments by a referee whose identity is unknown to me. That's the way that academic publishing works, that somebody reads what you've done, but they read it anonymously, so they comment on it and sort of take it apart and say, you know, this doesn't make sense, can you rewrite this bit, or can you look up this piece of evidence? So I've been doing that for an article. I don't know if it will pass muster by the time this goes on the blog, but you know, I've been, you know, it's a sort of higher level than what you might do at undergraduate studies. You know, it's effectively writing a big essay, but with more elements of primary source reading. Those are the sorts of things that the job entails.
If you could have one source history, what would it be and why?
Just one source?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even if it's a lost one. Or something.
I could have a lost source?
Yes.
Blimey, right. That's right, okay. I suppose if it was a lost source, I could sort of conceivably say the information that leads to Doomsday Book. Because we've got Doomsday Book, so that's the way of saying if you can only have one source. But, largely sort of British source, effectively, but you know, for Doomsday Book, if you could have just keep Doomsday Book, I think that's a desperately important one to save. But the records that lead up to Doomsday Book as well, we have bits of evidence for the southwest of the kind of detail, the additional detail that's recorded in the Doomsday Survey. And, I imagine if there were other records, because in making Doomsday Book, they went through the sort of local courts and found out who owned what and little bits of information, simply about numbers of animals, for example. And if that information was there as well for the whole of England in that period, I think that would be very interesting. That would sort of extend our knowledge. But that's just a, I'm sure I could think of other things that, you know, according to circumstances, but that's one that just sort of springs to mind.
Yeah, we have now a fun question.
All right, okay, that was a fun question.
Which one is your favourite historical figure?
Historical figure, right. Gosh. Yes.
Of figures, if you can decide.